Okay, welcome to the second video lecture of week two. So in the previous video lecture, I talked about exact fit and that usually exact fit is rejected. Now I'm going to talk about fit indices to test for closed fit to see if our model is still useful. And all these fit indices are based on the same idea. That is that we have a potentially really bad model, the baseline model. This is just the most simple model we can come up with. There are no, like there's no correlation or whatsoever between the items. Simply every item is assumed to have a variance and that's it. So we are explaining the variance of each variable, but not any of the covariance between any of the items. It's the most basic SEM model that we can think of. And then we have a saturated model, which is here, where we assume everything is correlated. So this always has degree of freedom equals zero because we have one parameter for each potential correlation in here, covariance in there. So that means that we always get perfect fit. So we also get, of course, t equals zero or chi square, if you want to call it, like that equals zero, that's the same thing. And somewhere in between this baseline world and this saturated world is our model. And now we want to know where are we in that model. And that's the whole idea behind all these fit indices. They try to place us somewhere on this scale. So the first fit indices that I want to talk about is the root mean square error of approximation. And this is a way to see if your model is close to the saturated model. So not exactly the saturated model, we're doing the chi square, but we want to test if it's close to the saturated model. And the way we obtain the root mean square of error, the RMSEA, is by taking our test statistic from the model minus the degrees of freedom from the model and dividing this by n times the degrees of freedom from the model. So basically it's the misfit per degree of freedom. And then we take the square root of that. So if the test statistic if is already lower than df, then this will just be something negative or zero. Basically, we just round it up to zero then. And that's usually not the case. And if it's higher than the degree of freedom, we see how much higher it is than the degree of freedom. And then we can do that. So here we have our Levan code to get our test statistic. And we get an RMSEA of 0.0921. And that's exactly what Levan also reports if you ask it directly for the RMSEA. Okay, so is that good? Is it bad? Well, in this case, that's pretty bad, actually. So there are some guidelines for the RMSEA. Not everybody agrees on the exact guidelines, but most people agree on the rough guidelines, and that is that above 0.1 is a very poor and unacceptable fit. We don't want that. And below 0.05 is a very good and close fit. We do want that. And then somewhere in between, we can say, okay, the fit is acceptable or it's not acceptable or it's fair. We'll disagree about that. Usually below 0.08 is still acceptable fit, like still mediocre or fair fit or good fit. But some will even say like 0.9 would be a mediocre fit or an okay fit. It depends a bit on who you ask, and there are many guidelines about this. But ideally, we want this to be as low as possible. Now, the nice thing about the RMSEA, it sets a fit index of which we also know the sampling distribution. And that's because the RMSEA is a direct function of this chi square. So because it's a direct function of the chi square, which you know is chi square distributed, which is t value, we also know the distribution of the RMSEA. And it turns out this thing has a non-central chi square distribution. And this allows us to test hypotheses with the RMSEA as well, just like we do with the chi square test. So one thing we can do is we can test for exact fit with the RMSEA. And then we simply test the hypothesis RMSEA equals zero. Well, this is not really anything new. Nobody really does this with RMSEA because this is the exact same thing that we already were doing with the chi-square test. But we can also test for other values than zero. And because this RMSEA is on a nice interpretable scale, where we can always say, okay, below 0.05 is pretty good, and like say above 0.08 is pretty bad, we can actually test these hypotheses. So we could test the hypothesis The RMCA is below some value that we consider good. And that means that if we reject this hypothesis, then that means that we reject the hypothesis that the RMCA is below some value that is considered good, which is, in our case, a bad thing to do. We can also test if the RMCA is above some value that is considered bad. And in this case, we do want to reject this hypothesis. Because if we can't reject the hypothesis that RMCA is above some value that's considered bad, then that's a bad thing for us. And these are the tests of close fit and the test of not close fit. Okay, so the test of close fit.
Cool.
The chi-square distribution has a non-central, the RMCA is a non-central chi-square distribution, which we can obtain. I have to the next slide. And then with the test of close fit, we want to test if, or we want to test the value if it's the RMCA is below some value that we consider close. We want to test if the RMCA is in this area here, which is good. And actually, we want to try to reject this test, or we try to falsify hypothesis. We hope we don't reject it, but that's what we try to do. So we look at this critical boundary here, where we would reject the test that RMCA is below this value. So with some boundary for the RMCA that we consider good, we can compute this non-centrality parameter of the chi-square distribution. And this is simply something that you can put into the chi-square distribution to shift the whole distribution a bit. And then we can perform our test. So we perform our test at the RMCA value of RMCA good, which in this case, let's say we put it at 0.05. We could put it, of course, at some other values as well, but let's say we want to test if RMCA is below 0.05. Now, in this case, we compute the non-centrality parameter, and then we can use the chi-square value in R to get a p-value, which is very significant in this case. And this we can also get from Levan itself directly with the RMCA p-value, which gives it the same result. And this is lower than 0.005 or whatever alpha we choose. So we reject the hypothesis that the model fits well. Reject the hypothesis that the model fits well. So that's a bad thing, because we don't want to reject the hypothesis that the model fits well. So this is not good, and this gives evidence that our model is not that good. Another thing we can do is try to reject the hypothesis that the model fits poorly. And why would we want to do both? Well, it could be that we just have very little data and this thing is like a distribution that's very, very wide, and we can't reject either of the hypotheses, and then we just have very noisy data. So now we pick a RMCA value that's bad, and we compute the corresponding chi-square distribution, and then we want to see if we can reject the test that the RMCA value is bad. So how do we do that? We compute our non-centrality parameter again, but now for some RMCA that's bad, let's say that's 0.08, but you can also consider like 0.1, for example. And then we get a non-centrality parameter, then we can perform our chi-square test, which uses the original model fit. And now we get a very non-significant p-value. So that means that we could not reject the hypothesis that the model fits poorly. So that's also bad, because we want to reject the hypothesis that the model fits poorly. But we couldn't. So we tried to reject it and we couldn't. So we can't even say that we reject a poor fit. So this is a bad sign usually for the model. Okay, that's it for the RMCA. Although I come back to the RMCA in the test for close fit and exact fit in one of the next videos about sample size. The other fit indices that you usually see reported, many of them are called incremental fit indices. And these are based on the idea that we want to compare a model to a baseline model. So where the RMCA compared it to the saturated model, now we're comparing a model to the baseline model, which is the most simple model we can think of, where nothing is correlated with each other. Okay, and then ideally we want our model to perform much better than the baseline model. So we want the baseline model to fit poorly and our model to fit much better. And why do we want that? It's because if the baseline model is just as good as our model that we came up with, even though we have all kinds of fancy latent variables and factor loadings and all kinds of stuff in there, but the most simple model we could think of pretty much is exactly the same, well, then we don't really need all that stuff that we came up with, because this baseline model, which is very simple, is already good. And that's a bad sign. Right? Then there's not really any reason to do all this modeling. And this can happen, especially if you have a low sample size, where you just have a low power to get really much more from your model than you would get from the baseline model alone. So the software will report the fit of the baseline model as well. Also, psychometrics, also computers on the side. And also degrees of freedom of the baseline model. And then previously I defined this TM, which is the fit of the model, and DFM, which is the degrees of freedom of the model. And with these four measures, you can pretty much compute all these incremental fitnesses. And there are a lot. So this is one thing that's very well known about SEM. There are many different fit indices, and there are more popping up all the time. Well, I think now it's sort of stopped, like especially 10, 20 years ago, I guess, these were just popping up all the time. And they always have some sort of abbreviation, usually ending on an I, like index. And then we have NFI, TLI, RFI, IFI, RNI, CFI, a lot of these things. And they're all pretty similar. They're usually between 0 and 1. Some can be above 1, but usually that is indicated really, really good fit, so that doesn't matter that much. They're usually between 0 and 1, and usually above 0.90 indicates a very good fit, or maybe like 0.92 or 0.93. There are some differences as well in how people, in recommendations people give. And all of them compare this fit of the baseline model to the fit of the model that we have with some sort of functions. And sometimes it's weighted with degrees of freedom. Like here, it's also weighted with degrees of freedom. This one doesn't use degrees of freedom. And there's some differences in there. And like there's a lot of work on that. And like some are good in some cases, some are good in other cases, things like that. Usually what you see is that people just report a lot of them. And that's also a nice thing to do. You just report several of them. And if they're all good, that's of course a good sign. And of course, don't cherry pick the ones that you're reporting. Right? Ideally, you pre-register which ones you're going to report, and then you just report those. Most commonly reported are CFI, TLI, NNFI, and some of these other ones as well. And if they're above 0.95, then that's a really good fit usually. But mostly above 0.90 is good. Then finally, we have the goodness of fit, the GFI, which is a measure that's a bit like the R squared or the explained variance that we have in regression. And this is a measure to really see how much S is closely resembles sigma. So how much is S like sigma? And these are also between 0 and 1. And again, higher is better, and above 0.90 would be a good thing. But they're not incremental fitnesses per se, because they're not comparing to a baseline model. And then there's the SRMR. And this is a measure that also looks at this, compares like if S resembles sigma. So this is based on the residuals, which is the average of the squared values in the residual correlation matrix. Usually it's better not to look at the SRMR itself, but rather to just look at the residuals. So one thing we can do is do sigma minus S or S minus sigma, or take the absolute value of that. And that gives us a matrix of differences. Right? So we get a matrix, and then we might see here minus 0.3, for example. Let's say there's a zero on the diagonal. Usually that's okay, the variances. Then this might indicate, oh, hey, look, there's a big residual in the implied correlation or covariance and the observed covariance of 0.3, which might be substantial. And then that might be evidence that, okay, maybe there's some misfit here, and then we should fix that problem, maybe the residual correlation or something like that. Okay, so this is the way that you look at residuals in Levan. And then here you get a lot of values here, of which some might be quite substantial. For example, here this -0.219 is a lot higher than all these other values, for example, and this one is also within that range as well. Okay, so a lot of fitnesses, a lot of information, and what do you do with that? Well, always report the chi-squared test with the degrees of freedom. That's the one thing you need to report. Also report the RMSEA, which is the most commonly used fitness and the one that's most interpretable. And also report several of these incremental fitnesses like CFI, RNI, and TLI. The tests for close fit and not close fit are not really reported that much. They're also a bit annoying to get. You can't really get them easily with software. We could build it into Psychonetrics if you want. That might be a nice SEM2 project. What you see more often is that you just simply report a confidence interval around the RMSEA, which is a 95-point confidence interval, which mostly gives you the same information as these close and not close fit tests. These are useful, though, also for sample size recommendations. So that's why I teach them. And try to make a good judgment based on what fitnesses you get. And of course, don't cherry pick the fitnesses that make your model look good. I think that goes without saying, but of course, sometimes you read a paper and you see three fitnesses reported, and then you run the code yourself and you see three other ones that are not as good, and then you think, okay, that's interesting that you chose those three to report. Okay, and that's it for this video on fitnesses.